So let's quickly review some of the basic concepts in seismic design philosophies. The development of formal building codes is basically led by some of the great disasters in the history. For example, we have the Great Fire of London, and then we also have some other disasters which led to the development of some documents which later on formally became the building codes. So we have, for example, the very first formal building code which was drafted and adopted in 1908. And then we also have the uniform building code in the context of seismic design and some other load design in 1927, and it was updated every 3 years. The last version of uniform building code was in 1997, and then the international building code started after that. We also have ASC 7 from American Society of Civil Engineers, and then from 1997 onwards we have the International Building Code, which is also being updated every 3 years. So we have different general code families. We also have, for example, UBC and IBC. We also have some other building codes of the American family of building codes, from ACI or AISC, and American Society of Civil Engineers also. And then we have Euro codes or British codes. We have also the codes from Australia and New Zealand. We have the codes from Japanese Society of Civil Engineers and the Korean Society of Civil Engineers, Chinese and Russian codes. We also have some the national codes of individual countries, for example, Indian standards or Thailand codes, the Myanmar National Building Code, and other building codes of individual countries. So these are some of the common families of traditional building codes, but the seismic design or analysis concepts for most of them are very similar, and the philosophy behind all of these codes have remained very close to each other. These are some of the building codes which we have discussed or mentioned. So the primary idea behind structural design, which is prescribed in these building codes, is that it should be a process of proportioning the structure to safely resist the applied forces in the most cost-effective manner and the friendly manner. So the idea is that you have load effects and you have some requirements and constraints. The design should be a process which should finally result in the material specifications, cross-section details, member sizes and configurations. So the design is a systematic investigation of the stability and strength and other properties of the structure. Safety is the prime concern, and sometimes stability of the structure also becomes one of the main design concerns. In all of these building codes, the primary design equation is same. The capacity should be greater than demand, and we know that they are related by a factor of safety. So the ratio between capacity and demand is a factor of safety. We started with applying the factor of safety only to the capacity side first by reducing the capacity. This 1 over factor of safety will become basically the strength reduction factors in case of, for example, American family of building codes. But then we also have on the other side where we apply the factor of safety to the demand side, which means that we amplify loads in order to analyze the structure and ensure the safety. But the ultimate strength design recognizes this idea that we should have a different factor of safety applied to the capacity side and a different factor of safety applied to the demand side. So the capacity is reduced at the same time the demand is increased or the load effects are increased, and the relationship between capacity and demand is maintained. And this process of doing all this will be part of structural design. The earlier approaches, this is just a revision for you, that the working stress design basically was of the idea that we can just simply apply the factor of safety to the capacity. So we don't go up to the ultimate capacity, we just apply a factor, a reduction factor, and we only use that reduced capacity for the purpose of structural analysis. All the load effects should use the capacity up to this point only. So there can be a significant part of unused strength and ductility which was not recognized in this working stress design. This is the very first idea. The real behavior we know already, that that the real behavior have far more complex shape for real structures. They don't have a very fixed kind of a capacity. They have some reserved strength as well as ductility. They have a feature called cyclic degradation. They have some other important concepts which were not incorporated in the working stress design. Then we move to the ultimate strength design, where we recognize that we can actually use the full strength of a material at ultimate strains. So we have defined the ultimate strains for all important materials, and then we use that full strength, and we also amplified the applied forces on the other hand. So for example, if we have a cross section, we can perform its cross-sectional analysis using nonlinear force and strain deformation, and that nonlinear force and stress distribution will utilize ultimately the complete strength of the material. So we use the actual stress strain relationships or the stress strain models of the material in this approach, and we come up with the full capacity of the material. But we don't look at the ductility side of the equation. We only focus in this approach towards utilizing the full material capacity and not on the full strain capacity or the ductility side of the equation. So we calculate the what we call as the stress resultants, the ultimate moment capacity on both sides if it is a column and only on one side if it is a beam, and the ultimate axial load carrying capacity. And that ultimate capacity is now compared with the amplified loads, not the working strength or stress, but the ultimate strength in this case. So we use different stress strain material models for concrete or steel. So these are some of the important stress strain behaviors for concrete, and these are for steel, for example. This is a simplified stress strain approach, which is the ACI Whitney rectangular block approach. It is a very simplified approach, and it idealizes the actual nonlinear stress strain behaviors. So we use these approaches to come up with the ultimate capacity, force capacity of the members, and then we use that in the analysis. We also consider the interaction of actions in this approach. So we have different actions within a member which are interacting with each other. The most common one is the axial load and moment interaction. We also call it as PM interaction, but we can also have shear torsion interaction. We can have shear flexural or torsion flexural or shear torsion flexural interaction. So these are at different levels of complexity. So the most common type of interaction considered in the design, mostly in the columns, is the PM interaction, the axial load and the flexure actions interaction. So we started with allowable stress design or working stress design, and then we have the ultimate strength design. At ultimate strength design, we are somewhere here that we are almost using the full capacity of the material. But we are not going beyond that. Going beyond that basically will bring that ductility effect into consideration, and that is not considered in USD. One step more than this will require here, and that will be basic idea behind plastic design. In the working stress design, we know that we have this simple equation that the demand should be less than allowable, and that allowable is a fraction of the actual capacity, some 40-50% of the actual capacity. But in ultimate strength design, we apply a separate factor of safety, a reduction factor to the demand, to the capacity side, and we have a separate factor on the demand side. And that obviously that we increase demand, so this factor should be greater than 1, and we reduce capacity, so this factor should be less than 1. And then we also have a new concept in this approach, that we can have different factor of safeties for the load effects coming from different kinds of loads, depending upon how much confident we are in the estimation of those loads. So for example, we can have a separate factor of safety or a kind of a load factor for a dead load moment, and a separate factor for the moment which is coming from live load. And also we can have different factors for different actions. So for moment we can have different, but for shear we can also have different. So, and similarly for axial loads we can have different. So different kinds of factor of safety depending upon the type of action as well as depending upon what load is causing that action, they were derived and put into put it into building codes, and then we use those factors now and come up with the amplified load effects, which should be compared with the capacity. The third approach is the limit state design, and the idea is that that we identify all the potential modes of failure. We identify significant limit states, basically. The modes of failure means a possible limit state or a possible failure which can be occurred in the design life of the structure. And what we do is that we determine the acceptable levels of safety against occurrence of each limit state. So it is an advancement over both working stress and ultimate strength design. So it uses more than one safety factors, starting from material up to the structure. So we have material level, and then cross section, and then member level, and then the structure level. This approach applies the factor of safety at all levels to ensure safety. So for example, some of the limit states which can be in our structures is that ultimate limit states will include loss of equilibrium, rupture, progressive collapse, formation of plastic mechanism, instability or fatigue. Serviceability will have, for example, excessive deflections, crack widths and vibrations. And there can be some special limit states. So you have to identify all possible limit states in your structure during the design life, which are intended or which can be anticipated. And then you have to come up with the acceptable level of the risk or the associated damage, you can say, for each limit state. And then you can have the factor of safety applied at each level. For example, the material safety factor, and then that material constitutes the cross section, and that cross section constitutes the member. So you can have a safety factor at member level. Similarly, on the load side, you can have a safety factor or the amplification factor on the load. And then you can also have the structural analysis factor or a factor accounting for the reliability of your structural analysis. So you can have the design member capacity coming from the structure side and the design member capacity coming from the load side. It is the required member capacity, basically. So then you can have a comparison between that, and that comparison should again have a safety factor at structure level. So that value of safety factor tells how much confidence we have on our knowledge. So the more confident we are about that phenomena, we will have a less safety factor on that. So for example, the structure level will have some safety factors. These will have some specific meanings, but I will not explain it now. The member level may have some other safety factors. At action level, for example, flexure, shear, torsion, or some other action, have different safety factors. Material level will have different. And then on load side, you will have either load factors, and then you can also have load combination factors, which account for the probability of simultaneous occurrence of different loads. The loads which can occur simultaneously, the probability is high. In that case, the load combination factor is also high. But if two loads cannot or very rare to have a simultaneous occurrence, the factor will be very low. So we started with this idea that we can just, you can say that we can just go up to some working stress or some proportion of the ultimate capacity of the structure. So in the seismic resistance design concept, the idea transformed into this, that we can apply the earthquake forces proportional to the building mass, and that forces can be just 5 to 10% of the weight of the building. The basic idea or the basic notion behind the equivalent lateral force procedure for the earthquake design. That what we can do is that we can simply apply some proportion of the building weight of the structure laterally in the direction, lateral direction to the structure, and then we can assume that the structure can resist this elastically, and those cross sections which will ensure that will become the final structural design. But this idea is characterized by the lack of knowledge on earthquake demand and building capacity. So you don't know what is the actual demand, you just assume it, and you also don't know what is the actual capacity, how the base shear versus roof displacement curve is going to bend or yield, or how it is going to behave in future. So you cannot answer the questions like what will happen if the demand more than this design demand come to your structure. You have no idea about that. What traditional building codes propose is that we can calculate what is called as the elastic demand on the structure, and then we can reduce it with a response modification factor R, and that modification factor basically accounts for the effect of ductility and overspan and other useful characteristics of the structure which can be used effectively to reduce the seismic demands. So you have the elastic demands shown by this line, and then the code say that you don't design on these demands, basically you design on reduced demands reduced by the factor R. So this whole ratio between this level and this level is the factor R. So by doing so, what you are essentially doing that you are allowing your structure to yield and actually use that inelastic capacity or inelastic response or ductility and all those useful features in order to reduce the overall cost of the structure. So the traditional building codes are based on this response modification. But the current design approach is the explicit consideration of the inelastic capacity of the structure. So the current approach says that you actually draw this curve, you actually get this curve which is telling you the inelastic capacity. So now if you have, for example, the base shear and roof displacement or some other force parameter and displacement parameter on y and x axis respectively, then you should plot exactly the real nonlinear behavior. And this real nonlinear behavior is going to come from a nonlinear analysis, nonlinear static analysis. For that, you need to have a nonlinear computer model of your structure. So nonlinear modeling or nonlinear analysis, the explicit analysis, is the part of the current seismic design approach. And also the performance-based seismic design, at the heart of it is the nonlinear analysis. So you must learn the nonlinear modeling, and you should know how to perform the nonlinear analysis. So now you have the force demand here, and you have the actual nonlinear curve. You modify the force demand based on the, for example, inelastic properties of your structure or damping, for example, and then you come up with a point which is a compromise point between the demand and capacity. This point basically is a result of utilizing the full nonlinear capacity both on the force side as well as on the displacement side. So basically we have, you can say, used both the reserve strength as well as the reserve ductility of the actual structure. So the current seismic design approach is based on the actual nonlinear behavior and the actual inelastic response of the structure. So we have now different design philosophies on our menu. For example, we can have force or stress-based design. The basic idea is that the demand and the capacity relationship, the demand should be less than capacity in terms of forces and not in terms of displacements. The displacement-based design actually explicitly considers displacements. It allows the force-DC ratios to exceed as long as the displacements can be limited. So this idea, displacement-based design, is basically a kind of an acceptance of the approach that the displacements are a true measure of damage. The structure damages when the displacements increase from some specific values. So now the DC measure or the demand to capacity ratios in this approach are measured in terms of displacements and not forces. The capacity based design is a further next step, that it says that you should put some ductile elements or what we call as the structural fuses in the structure, limit the force capacity and hence the demand. So you should put some ductile elements which are designed to yield, which you know that they will yield in case of the design earthquake. And those fuses should be replaceable and should be properly detailed and should be confined properly. For example, some of the elements, they can be allowed safely to yield to dissipate seismic energy. So in capacity-based design, you yourself decide which element should remain elastic and which element should yield during the design earthquake. So this is a more refined idea And then we also have an energy based design in which the primary concern is the dissipated energy. The total energy input is collectively resisted by kinetic energy, which is used to move the structure, for example. The elastic strain energy, which is used to deform the structure within the elastic limit. And the energy dissipated through plastic deformations and damping, which means that that energy which is used to deform the structure into inelastic range or plastic range. So in this energy based design, the design equation will be in energy terms. It should be that the input energy should be effectively dissipated, or the structure should have a energy dissipating capacity more than the input energy. The design equation will be in the energy terms. So these are some of the terms which will be used not basically in the performance based design, but as a context to which led to the development of performance based design. So in force based approach or the strength based approach, we have the DC measure in terms of forces. We will ensure that the, for example, shear capacity should be more than shear demand. And the maximum safe value of a particular force action should be considered the capacity, and the maximum value that the particular action caused by the applied loads should be the demand. But both the capacity and demands are in terms of forces. In displacement based approach, the demand and capacity, both measures are in terms of displacements. For example, the deformation capacity should be greater than deformation demand. Deformation demand means that maximum value of the deformation which is caused by the applied loading, and deformation capacity is the maximum capacity of the structure to deform under the same deformation. So it is the maximum safe value of a particular deformation that can be displacement or rotation, curvature or material strain, for example. So these deformations can be at any level. For example, they can be at material level, for example, material strain. They can be at cross-section level, for example, cross-sectional curvature. They can be at member level, for example, member rotation. And they can be at a whole structure level, for example, roof displacement of the structure. But the DC ratio is in the form of deformations. So force-based approach had these two approaches. Displacement-based approach can be used as an umbrella term for capacity design or direct displacement based design or some other approaches, for example, and also it can be used as an umbrella term for performance based design approach, because in PBD approach also we use mostly the strain DC ratios or the deformation demand to capacity ratios. The idea is that, for example, if we have stress on y axis for a material and strain on x axis, as long as the strain caused by the applied loading is less than the strain capacity. For example, if we define this number as the strain capacity of the material, and after that the structure degrades, as long as the strains caused by applied loading is less than this strain capacity, the structure is safe, and you can still use that structure, and you can define different levels of the capacity, and then after the end of the analysis you can say that, okay, what is the actual behavior or performance of that material during the analysis, whether it reached to this level or this level or up to this level, or it can reach up to the last level or degraded level also. So performance based approach is also based on the idea that the deformations and displacements of ductile elements should be used as the DC measure or the demand to capacity measure or ratio. So the capacity design is a design process in which it is decided which objects within a structural element will be permitted to yield, and those will be defined or declared as the ductile components, and which objects will remain elastic. Those will be brittle components, because obviously the elements which will be designed to yield will be having special detailing, for example, in case of RC, and their demand to capacity ratios will be in the form of deformations and not forces. On the other hand, the brittle components, they will be made stronger, and their DC ratios will be in the form of forces. You will not allow any inelastic action or yielding in these elements, so you will have forces as their DC main. So the ductile elements are designed with sufficient deformation capacity such that they may satisfy displacement based DC ratio. But brittle elements are designed to achieve sufficient strength such that they may satisfy strength based demand to capacity ratio. So in design earthquake, you will allow these elements to yield, you will not allow these elements to yield. So those elements which you will not allow to yield, they can have a brittle failure, but their force capacities are far beyond what is required for the structure to remain elastic. They should be more than that so that they will not yield. Professor Murthy gave a very good example of the analogy for capacity based design, and that is the ductile link analogy. He says that, for example, if your structure is a chain, and in that chain you have brittle links, the red ones, and you have one ductile link which has the capacity to yield safely. So that ductile link will result in ultimately the whole chain to behave in a ductile manner, because all of the inelastic deformations will be concentrated in that ductile link, and that ductile link stretches by yielding before breaking. But the brittle links can be made strong to remain elastic, and the ductile link can be made ductile or confined in case of RC member, or specially detailed in case of RC member, so that it can take all the inelastic deformations. The structure as a whole, or the whole chain, will behave in a ductile manner if you can perform this idea. So the brittle links are those elements which are force controlled, and ductile links are those elements in your structure which are deformation controlled, or they will have the DC measure in terms of displacements.